Cancer diagnosis can feel like the end of the world. The path you choose next and the people you choose to accompany you can make all the difference. The Baystate Regional Cancer Program, experts in cancer, every step of the way.
Put a local perspective on the war against cancer, we sat down with Dr. Wilson Mertens. He's Vice President for Cancer Services at Baystate Medical Center. The full disclosure, Baystate is underwriting our local presentation of the documentary. Well, Dr. Mertens talked about the difficulty involved in finding a cure when there are so many types of cancer.
Here we've got 25 big classifications of disease, maybe 60 diseases commonly, maybe 120 different presentations, and now we're understanding different molecular subtypes as we continue to subdivide the disease into different prognostic categories and different treatment categories. And the treatments are very different, and unfortunately, as we think about cancer as one disease and we're going to then seek a cure for this disease, as if we would seek a cure for coronary artery disease or heart, it's so multifaceted that I think we're not going to get there as a simple solution.
Can you envision a time when cancer, if not curable, is treatable, a chronic illness as opposed to a fatal illness, or does the very nature of the illness cancer, what it is and what it does in and to the body, does that not really make that a possibility?
It's a growing possibility. More and more of our cancers are being converted into this kind of management style. For example, advanced lung cancer used to have a terrible prognosis, and it still does. It's not a curable cancer, and patients die all too soon from that disease. But we have subsets of the disease now identified through molecular testing that allow for different treatments that can extend life and manage symptoms. Supporting that is a quality of life movement that is relatively new in cancer, still developing, that looks to manage cancer, not necessarily with typical cancer medications, depending on where the patient is in their journey, but to look at more supportive care options that have their own survival benefit and certainly quality of life benefit.
Chemotherapy and radiation still remain fairly common treatment in many cases of cancers. They are hard on a patient, they're exhausting, but a fair rate of success, it appears, in terms of attacking cancer and extending life.
Certainly in early stage disease, where we can use these treatments to manage patients who do not have a large burden of cancer that may have spread throughout the body. So early intervention for breast cancer, early intervention for lung cancer, where patients may be candidates for additional chemotherapy after potentially curative surgery and improve their cure rates by 25 to 35%, which in lung cancer is not small. So yeah, for the foreseeable future, we believe that conventional chemotherapy with modifications and new drugs will continue to be a bulwark of treatment, particularly for the early stages of cancer.
If someone hears that diagnosis from their physician, and I don't know if there are three more frightening words in the English language, you have cancer. From your point of view, what would you say is the first step, you think, the first thing for that patient to do to determine and start their path of treatment?
Well, I think they need to stop and catch their breath. For most patients with cancer, not all, but most, taking 2 or 3 days to gather one's thoughts is helpful rather than deleterious. But I think they need to kind of ask themselves, who should be on my team? What team of physicians, what hospital system should be on my team? And the team for treating cancer is actually very broad, and most patients will never see the entire team. It takes hundreds of folks in a healthcare system and beyond to manage cancer, including in some cases insurance companies. Who's going to be looking at my pathology? What is their expertise? Have the appropriate tests been done? What do I need in terms of additional testing to gather the information about the extent of my cancer? I think at the end of the day, it's a relational situation like most healthcare, and a strong comfort with your treating team is important. But I think people need to realize that almost all cancers, even relatively small ones, are treated not just by one doctor, but but by multiple specialties all converging on one patient. So seeing the robustness of that team and its capabilities, I think that's probably the major question to ask.
It seems to me, in general, after our brief discussion here, you are hopeful in terms of the coming years and medical science continuing battle against cancer.
Yeah, I am. I think we're making slow and steady progress. Where I think we need to do more work, though, is on the delivery system. And we will see the full Ken Burns series and how his exploration of cancer and Dr. Mukherjee's book backing that will play out. But one of the challenges we have in terms of research is that we are doing incrementally better, but we're working the research on a platform that hasn't really changed much since the 70s in terms of grant funding and direction to of treatment. When we think about healthcare delivery systems, not much has changed nationally in terms of cancer care delivery systems since the late 80s or early 90s. Financing all of this, it hasn't really changed much since the health maintenance organizations first came on the scene in the early 90s. And so we are trying to make substantial progress with research, care delivery, and care finance models that really haven't changed much in a quarter century. If we're going to make big breakthroughs with more personalized medicine, with more complicated treatment schemes, with more evolved ways of evaluating tumors and their extent, we're going to have to change that delivery scheme. We're probably going to have to reimagine all of that. At the moment, we have a relatively low reliability system. When you think about patients getting chemotherapy and the work that has been done, even in supportive care, we now know with level one evidence what best anti-nausea prevention should be for various chemotherapy regimens. And yet in this country, the delivery rate of that is somewhere between 15 and 35%. That's a problem. When we look at adjuvant or additional therapy, curative chemotherapy after surgery for colon cancer, and that's not delivered appropriately or accurately a third of the time, that's a problem. We can do all the research we want. If we don't deliver the care with high reliability, we're not going to deliver to the American people the kind of outcomes that the research promise holds. And so that has to be reviewed, I think, and it's going to take some time and some work and some courage.
Well, Dr. Wilson-Mertens, thanks so much for coming in. Appreciate your time, sir.
Jim, thank you so much.